Hey everyone, this is Brad. Good morning or afternoon or evening, depending on when you're actually watching this. So, if you're watching this, then you found the lectures in the lecture folder. That's great. So this is how I guess the rest of the semester is gonna proceed going forward. So I'll upload these on Wednesday, or sorry, Monday and Wednesday. I'll, sort of go over the lecture, go over any sort of upcoming assignments, things to remember, all that. And then what I want to do today is, give a sort of a review of what's going to go on going forward throughout the rest of the semester. And then do a bit of a review on Kuhn since we've been gone for a couple of weeks. And then look at these three theorists that make up this chapter for Godfrey Smith. So, I'm going to be doing it in a bit of a different order than Godfrey Smith. So, in any event, we're still going to be discussing the same three. So we will start with Paul Feyerabend, then look at Imre Lakatos, and finally Larry Loudon. And this is what I'm hoping to be this transition from the sort of objective discussion of the sciences that we were dealing with the problem of induction, logical positivism, Karl Popper, Thomas Kuhn, into this transition going forward, really questioning the objectivity of the sciences, really looking at the sciences sociologically, looking at what it is that scientists do, right? And what I hope today is going to show is that there's a logical progression there, that what happens in the work that specifically Imre Lakatos and Larry Loudon do starts to ask those types of questions that were suggested by Kuhn. The way that he describes this transition from one paradigm to another, and how these relate to questions that we're going to be asking on Wednesday, and then again next week with Merton's essay, and then Hansen, right? What is it the scientists do? How are scientists affected by, what typically motivates all of us? So, prior to getting into today's reading, let's just I want to go over a few things. So just as a reminder, we already went over this prior to break, but right. So quiz number three is due tonight. That should be on Blackboard. I saw some of you already have it done. If you do not, make sure that it is done by the due date now for these, since we're no longer holding in-person classes, has been shifted to the end of the day. So 11:59 p.m. tonight. That's going to be for all our assignments going forward. So quiz three is due tonight. That's all in the stuff from Kuhn, if you haven't done it yet, I think it's like two short answer questions. So again, nothing too terribly onerous coming right back into everything. Right, so I had mentioned this. If you take a look at the syllabus, response paper four has been removed. With missing the extra week, there's only so many readings to go around, something had to give. But you're all still getting credit for response paper four. So everybody just gets a 20 out of 20 for that. So it's not going to take up your one dropping your lowest grade. You'll still have that for whatever your lowest grade outside of response paper four is going to be. And if I just had eliminated it, it would have just weighted everything else heavier, which wasn't really fair either. So the only fair option here is to give everyone just full credit for response paper four, and everyone's sort of at the same level there, right? So just as a reminder then, response paper five is due on the 13th, so you still have a good bit of time for that. I think it's 2 weeks from today. If anybody has any questions on that, we can discuss that. But again, that's going to be on more so some of the stuff from Wednesday, and then certainly the stuff we're working with next week. So response paper five on the 13th, response paper six, the final essay, they're all going to be uploaded to Blackboard. So I already have the response paper five, response paper six set to upload to Blackboard. They won't appear for you until it gets closer to the date, though. But once we're finished with the lectures for that, it will open up for you to upload that. So make sure you're uploading them there. If for some reason the upload doesn't work or Blackboard goes down, I'll touch base as far as like emailing them or something. But for now, upload them to Blackboard. Right, take a look at the syllabus because it has changed due to our extra week of spring break. Some of the readings have changed. Today's is still the same, but Wednesday's reading is different. If you haven't downloaded the new syllabus yet or taken a look at it, please do so. Office hours, obviously by appointment via Skype or Zoom. I'm always going to be available during my normal office hours, so from 8:30 to 9:30 in the mornings, and then obviously during our class time as well. This is a time that I already sort of blocked out for our class because I'd be typically standing in front of you teaching right now. So I'm saying right now, like I'm assuming you're watching this during our class time, but I guess you wouldn't have to be. But in any event, if you'd like to discuss anything, yeah, shoot me an email when you'd like to, you know, sort of meet, and we can set up a time to do that. I'm available other times as well. Clearly, we don't have a ton to do here, but I'll always be available during my office hours in our class. Okay, so post-Kuhn theorists. So this is sort of the lay of the land here, is like, you know, how people deal with structure, right? So we're looking at this period in the late 1960s, early 1970s, of, you know, in the wake of Kuhn publishing Structure of Scientific Revolutions, how others are responding to, I think, what Godfrey Smith refers to as this bomb drop that was structure, right? This entirely new way of thinking about scientific progress, about what scientists do, about how decisions are made in the sciences, right? So I'd said I wanted to look at these three theorists that Godfrey Smith discusses: Feyerabend, Lakatos, and Loudon. Yeah, so like, this is kind of the last week that we're going to be doing these types of discussions. So what we've been doing up to this point over the course of the semester is really giving you like a chronology of major thinkers in the last 100 years of philosophy of science. Well, a little further, right? So we start with David Hume, his work on cause and effect, his work on inductive reasoning, right? And then we move up through, the next big name we deal with is Hempel, right, with his hypothetico-deductive method in the essay on Semmelweis, with his Raven paradox. We look at some big names trying to vindicate induction, so Reichenbach and Strawson. We look at Karl Popper's conception of scientific progress and how he sort of avoids the problem of induction. Then we look at Kuhn, and now we're looking at these three like post-Kuhn theorists. After this, we really shift focus, not that we won't be focusing on individuals anymore, but our readings are more guided by large issues or large movements or large questions in philosophy of science, rather than being guided by one or several sort of hugely influential individuals. So we shift from, it's no longer a discussion of Hempel's view of science or Popper's view, it's a more general discussion of sociology of science, objectivity in science, gender issues in science, these types of things. So more issue-based than, I guess, person-based. But for now, for this week, we're going to see how these three sort of facilitate that transition into these other types of questions. Right, so as a review, I mean, all of them are working with certain issues that they have with Kuhn's conception of science and scientific progress, right? So as a review, we remember there were these two periods of science for Kuhn: normal science and revolution. Normal science was guided by a paradigm. It was relatively orderly. We were puzzle solving, not problem solving. And scientists are relatively happy with normal science. Revolutionary science is these sort of small but hugely influential periods of great change. And that change could either be positive or negative. We discussed that. These are facilitated by a crisis. So a crisis is these anomalies or puzzles that resist solution, when normal science breaks down. And then a scientific revolution is when you lose faith in your paradigm because of the importance of the anomalies that you have found that you can't reconcile. And then another paradigm comes on the scene that appears to have more explanatory power than your old paradigm, right? So you compare these paradigms with each other in the world, and scientists decide as a collective group to shift from one paradigm to the other. Scientists decided to shift from the geocentric view to the heliocentric view, from Ptolemy's view to Copernicus's view, right? So these three writers each take issue with parts of the story that Kuhn is telling here. So this is Paul Feyerabend. I love this picture. If you search Paul Feyerabend, you get a lot of really great photos. He was I think Godfrey Smith refers to him as like the wild man of philosophy of science, and you know, both in personal sort of demeanor and the things that he writes about and the way that he argues, the title is, I think, well deserved. Right. So he was an Austrian philosopher of science. 24 to 94 were his dates. He taught for most of his life, I think, like 30 years at UC Berkeley. He has an asteroid named after him, which is, you know, pretty cool. Yeah, so like Godfrey Smith says about this wild man, he's probably the most controversial post-Kuhn figure His book is probably one of the most controversial books in the philosophy of science at the time, this Against Method, sort of I guess an anarchistic view of the sciences. What was Feyerabend's issue? Yeah, so with Loudon and with Lakatos, we're going to see them taking issue with Kuhn's views of scientific revolution as something irrational or something too arbitrary or subjective to be correct. Feyerabend, on the other hand, really took issue with Kuhn's conception of normal science. He thought that what Kuhn was saying is that scientists should take things on faith. Remember, during normal science, we don't question our fundamentals. We assume that Mendel was correct on genetics if we work within the paradigm of genes, a paradigm of modern genetics. We assume that Darwin was correct if we're working under the paradigm of evolutionary biology, or that Einstein was correct if we're working in astronomy. So he felt like Feyerabend felt like Kuhn was asking scientists to take things on faith, not question, to shut down question, to become sort of too orderly, too mechanical, and this was something that Feyerabend was sort of opposed to. Yeah, he felt like sort of normal science straitjackets scientific creativity, right? This rule following, we don't think outside the box. We follow what our paradigm is telling us, and we don't question those fundamentals. And he felt like, with these types of rules in general, a good scientist needed to be sort of creative in order to think outside that paradigm and to do things outside of the box. And he says charismatic as well. I guess this is like so other people actually listen to him. Certainly, I think he was thinking of himself there. So he also says, I think we forget that during normal science, what we place our faith in can often lead us in the wrong direction. So Godfrey Smith talks about this as like this argument from history that haunts philosophy of science. And this is sort of very, sort of, I don't know, it's a kind of a bit of a, well, it's very hyperbolic, I guess. Yeah, that's what I was looking for, hyperbolic. So, what is this argument? He does. So Feyerabend talks about in Against Method this idea of Galileo's views on the arguing that we were the moving piece, that we were actually revolving, and the sun rising and setting was because of our movement rather than the sun's. Feyerabend talks about this experiment that geocentric scientists had done that they thought, quote unquote, disproved Galileo's theories that we were moving. This is something that I would have, were we in class, written on the board. Let's see if I can do this here by sketching it out. So, essentially, what, so let's say there are two options for the way the universe works, right? One is we are the stable center, that we're relatively flat, and the other is that we are on a sphere that is floating in space, right? That we are revolving, we are spinning. Right, so in each of these, what the geocentric model, what the proponent said is like, okay, so imagine you have a tower, right? And so you have a tower here as well. Right, so imagine you have a tower and you go to the top of the tower and you drop a ball off of the tower, right? So let's say you stand up here and you drop it's a nice ball, right? And if we are standing still, what we would expect is that the ball would go straight down. Right? We're not moving. So when we drop it, the ball, if it's, let's say, the distance here is 5 feet out from the tower, if we're not moving, if we're not spinning, then the distance should be 5 feet down here at the bottom, right? Over here, though, if we're moving, right? So let's say we're spinning. Okay, so we're spinning this way. And if we dropped a ball 5 feet off the tower here, once the ball is in the air, they thought the ball shouldn't be moving or shouldn't be spinning, in the same way. So when you drop the ball here, if it's 5 feet out from the tower at the top when you drop it, but remember the tower is moving this way, the ball should be closer to the tower when it lands. Right, as this tower spins. Now, likewise, if let's say we're spinning the other way, well, then if I drop the ball from 5 feet out, then the ball should be further out when it lands as the tower is moving further away from us. Now, we know this isn't true because of mixed motion, right? Because as the tower is spinning either clockwise or counterclockwise, the ball is not only falling this way, right? It's spinning this way as well. But what Feyerabend's point is not that the geocentric model was correct, it's that they put their faith in observations. This was a scientific experiment in the ways that we've talked about them. They proposed a hypothesis. If we are standing still when I drop this ball, it should be the same distance at the bottom as it was from the top. And if we are spinning, the ball should either be closer to the tower or further away from the tower. And they did their observation, and what they saw was evidence that supported this model over here. They're wrong, obviously, but not because of anything they observed. So when what Feyerabend's point is not to show that the geocentric model was maybe more correct than we thought it was, but to argue that like if we say we think modern science is correct by saying, look how well it fits with observable evidence, we forget that the geocentric model fits very well with observable evidence, depending on how we craft observations, depending on what we craft as our evidence. This is going to become much more important next class when we talk about this work, Leviathan and the Air Pump, on this debate between Thomas Hobbes and Boyle regarding the presence of vacuums. But yeah, he says, you know, when we hold up modern science as fitting with observable evidence, we forget this. You know, what good is observable evidence if it leads us astray in this way? So what he says ultimately, Feyerabend's ultimate point is that scientists should take more chances. They need to be constantly proposing new theories, at the same time giving existing theories more benefit of the doubt, right? So sort of doing things that normal science was not supposed to do, which was constantly bringing up new theories. So he brings up these two principles that he think would help science, this principle of tenacity and this principle of proliferation. Principle of tenacity, we sort of discussed with relation to Kuhn. Feyerabend fleshes out a bit more. Because we need to give theories more time to develop. Despite any initial problems, we need to allow for certain newly formed theories to have time to grow, to have time to be protected from sort of disconfirmation. And this might allow for more creativity. And certainly this principle of proliferation. Feyerabend really thought like we shouldn't wait for a crisis to introduce new ideas, that there's no reason to say I need to wait for something to go wrong to propose something radical and outside of our current paradigm. And what he says might help here is like a division of labor. Like he recognizes that some scientists are going to be better at normal science. Some are going to be better at evolutionary science or proposing new ideas. So he says, okay, fine, let's put some of them to puzzle solving. If you're a good puzzle solver, let's do that. But others maybe aren't good puzzle solvers, but they're creative in a way that they could constantly be proposing new theories. So we need this sort of division of labor. We're going to get back to that idea a few times, most notably with Larry Loudon near the end here, and then also with our discussion next class and next week as to like what motivates scientists. So, like I said, you know, whereas Feyerabend is sort of, you know, concerned with Kuhn in respect to where he thinks he went astray with normal science, Imre Lakatos and Larry Loudon are both more concerned with this conception of, well, the singular nature of a paradigm and how that relates to our decisions during scientific revolution. So yeah, so Imre Lakatos is a Hungarian philosopher of science. He worked with Karl Popper at the same time at the London School of Economics. He fled Hungary after the Second World War when the Soviets took over Hungary. So yeah, so like I said, these two issues for Lakatos. Felt that Kuhn's view was irrational, which we'll discuss in a second, and that we, to say that science or a scientific discipline is only driven by one paradigm at a time is simply incorrect and is not helpful. So, why are paradigm shifts irrational? Lakatos didn't think that, you know, Lakatos thought that there was some good to what Kuhn was doing. It's certainly better than Popper's view of conjecture and refutation, that as soon as we find a disconfirming observation, we eliminate our theory and we go back to the drawing board. He felt like Kuhn preserved something of science there. But at the same time, he felt like what Kuhn was proposing to put in its place, this idea of a paradigm shift in the way that he talks about it, was what he refers as destructive to scientific rigor and scientific progress. And ultimately, he thought that like Kuhn's idea of when and how we move from one paradigm to the other was too subjective, too chaotic, too irrational, or as I say here, arbitrary, to be a way to describe what actually happens, or that even if it did work in this way, it wouldn't be very useful for science. Yeah, so he says under Kuhn, the way scientific change works during revolutionary periods is fundamentally irrational. Right? Not in our acknowledging of anomalies or trying to fix them, but in the way that we respond to crises, the way that we move from one paradigm to another. So, why? He says, well, look at it this way. The only time paradigms ever really have to or are necessitated to interact with one another is during a time of crisis, right? We had shown this as like there's you know, one paradigm is the old paradigm, like the geocentric view, the other is the heliocentric view, and we compare them to the world and to each other, right? So they have to sort of be in contact with each other here so we can decide which one we think is the better paradigm, the more promising paradigm. But we had talked about this in the last few weeks with Kuhn, that there's, based on what paradigms govern for a period of science or a scientific discipline, there's an inherent incommensurability or an inability to communicate between scientific disciplines working under different paradigms. We can extend this to two paradigms, to what Kuhn would call warring paradigms, during a scientific revolution, right? If each paradigm defines success in its own way and defines what we should observe and how we should do experiments and who we should listen to and who we should ignore, there's no communication between those paradigms there either. So essentially, what Lakatos asks is, if we have an inability to communicate, to effectively compare one paradigm with another, how do we decide which paradigm is better? When each paradigm is defining success, essentially what is better for themselves? And he says the real risk here is that scientific change becomes a sort of mob mentality for Kuhn, where when we have enough scientists deciding to switch from one to the other, that's when we decide, and it's merely a popularity contest between two paradigms. Lakatos really didn't like that, right? He thought that was just way too arbitrary and irrational to talk about, to adequately describe how science works or how scientific change works. He identifies this problem as, well, what if we didn't have to just say there's one paradigm working at a time? What if we could say that a scientific discipline can hold more than one worldview at the same time, that these are not incommensurable, that they can actually communicate with one another? This would be much more beneficial for science if we could have something that works similarly to a paradigm, but it's more rigorous and can coexist with other paradigms within one scientific discipline. And for Lakatos, this is a scientific research program, right? That's his term for his paradigm-like collection of views for a scientific discipline, a research program. So, similar to paradigms in most ways. Everything in your notes that we've talked about a paradigm governing is the same thing that's governed by a research program. The difference is that they're not singular like paradigms. Scientific disciplines can hold more than one research program at the same time. And because of that, scientific change becomes much more orderly in a research program. Progress for a research program is once again cumulative within a research program. So progress is always working in the right direction. This isn't Popper's strict conjecture and refutation, on the other hand. So it's sort of like vacillating between the two. So Lakatos structures these research programs in a way that he thinks better describes what a research program is, and also where change occurs, and when and why a research program might be abandoned. So he sees these research programs as having two areas of, or collections of beliefs, what he calls this hardcore and this protective belt. So I'm going to try again to do one of my poor drawings here. So, I mean, it really should look like, you know, two concentric circles. So you have this hardcore, and then around it, you have this protective belt. Sorry, there should be like good circles. I'm not very, yeah, well, It is what it is. I'm better on a whiteboard and I'm not good on a whiteboard. In any event, he puts our beliefs, the beliefs of any scientific research program, into either beliefs that fit into this hard core or into this protective belt. The hard core is going to be this basic set of beliefs that are essential to the research program itself. These are unchanging. These are the core beliefs of a scientific research program. And it's not like they're taken on faith, but like what he says is like if they change, the whole research program falls. This whole model is destroyed here. Alternatively, what we find in the protective belt around the outer periphery are beliefs that are less central. Right? We think that they're true, but they're not essential. In other words, the whole thing doesn't fall apart if they turn out not to be true. So if we look at evolutionary biology, for instance, we have here the hard core, right? So the hard core in red. Right, so we have the hard core. And we also have this protective belt. Right, so around that hard core then are the collection of maybe not as beliefs that are not as central. Right, so for evolutionary biology, the beliefs in our hard core, the basic tenets of Darwin, right? His ideas of natural selection, familial genetic similarities, and how and why variations take place, that there is some genetic link between species that seem biologically distinct, right? There is a link between a whale and a bear because they're both mammals, despite these sort of distinct or disparate features, right? That, though one is a land animal and one is a sea animal, a whale has more in common with a bear than it does with a fish, right? So all of these then are going to be, in here, right? They all make up this, oh geez, they all make up this hard core of this theory. I'm using a touchpad for this and I apologize. They don't go out like that. So other beliefs are going to be part of this protective belt, right? They're not as essential. Those are sort of, out here. Right, so how species are related, specific species, right? How bears and whales are related, how dinosaurs evolved into birds, right? All these things are important to evolutionary biology, but if we find out that like something different happened in the ways the dinosaurs evolved, or that we missed a step in how we got from land animal mammals back to sea animal mammals, it doesn't threaten the whole research program, right? So what features can be accounted for by natural selection? We think that a feature is natural selection, we turns out it's not. It doesn't threaten our whole view of evolutionary biology. If we describe how a specific gene works, that's out here in this protective belt, it's important. We think that it's true, but if it turns out not to be true, it doesn't threaten the whole thing. So anomalies are always going to be accounted for in this protective belt. This is change within a research program. Change within a research program only happens in the protective belt. The hard core can never change. And the type of change that occurs in a protective belt is going to determine the health of that research program. So any change in any change that expands explanatory power is going to be beneficial. Detrimental changes are going to be modifications that don't expand the research program, these small fixes. The epicycles of Venus are a good example of detrimental change to a research program. They don't expand the explanatory power. They actually diminish it. They create more problems than they solve, as we discussed. So for Lakatos, this detrimental change, only making these small fixes that don't expand anything, is a symptom of a research program in decline. It suggests that one day we might have to let this research program go. Like Kuhn, there might be something more fundamentally wrong with it. But it doesn't have to be abandoned, and not for the reasons that Kuhn says. It might not be abandoned for strictly, I don't want to say personal reasons, but for strictly functional or pragmatic reasons. We might preserve it in the hopes that it'll turn around. Now, it probably not going to, but if it does, we'd have to think the payoff would be big. Right? So change happens, we change research programs, the change outside of or the substitution of one research program for another happens when we compare a healthy research program against one that's in decline, and we decide that we need to switch research programs. This isn't the only reason that we would switch or follow or change research programs. This is where Larry Loudon comes in. Larry Loudon has the distinction of, as far as I can remember, being the first theorist that we've discussed who's still alive. He teaches at University of Texas, Austin, I want to say. Anyway, also the first sort of, well, no, I guess Kuhn was. Well, in any event, he is an American philosopher of science. He's a pragmatist. So you'll see this in the way that he describes the work of the scientific community here. But also, for those of you who found Reichenbach's work compelling with his pragmatic vindication of induction, I know there were a lot that did based on the midterm essays. Do check out Progress and Its Problems. That's a really good work by Loudon that offers a pragmatic view of what scientists do. And what he does is he takes this work that Lakatos is doing with this research program and adapts it or uses it to create what he calls a research tradition. So, it's research tradition. What Loudon says is, well, once we have research programs that can coexist within a scientific discipline at the same time, this opens up this possibility of having research traditions, right, that have a bunch of different research programs all working in a scientific discipline at the same time. So we can think of a research tradition as a collection of research programs within one scientific field of study, one scientific discipline. So Loudon argues that what he sees is there might be a lot of positions we take towards one's own research program, what we work with, what we pursue. Right. So for Lakatos and Kuhn, we only really have one stance toward a research program, belief. Our stance might differ quantitatively, more or less belief. I might have more belief or less belief in my research program or in my paradigm, but if I'm working within it necessitates or suggests some level of belief. Right? If I'm working in a research program or under a paradigm, we always do have some faith in them or believe that they're true to some extent, but that the strength in our belief might differ. I might think that one is more likely or less likely, but I believe it to some extent. This isn't true for Loudon. For a research program for Loudon, we can have a position or a stance toward it that can differ both quantitatively in how much we believe it, but also qualitatively, whether us working in a research program necessitates belief at all. And he argues that it doesn't. He's going to say that these qualitatively different positions are going to be what he calls acceptance and what he calls pursuit. So, acceptance. Acceptance is pretty much the same as belief, right? To accept a research program is to take it to be true, to have faith in it or to believe it to be the case, right? I accept the, current model of relativity is how the universe is created, right? I accept Darwin's theory of evolution, right? It implies belief in. Pursuit, though, is different. So pursuit doesn't necessitate belief. In other words, I could pursue a research program. I could investigate a research program without claiming that I believe in it, right? He says to pursue a research program is to follow or to investigate or to work within a research program or to work on certain questions or in a certain area without any belief that what you're working in is true. This doesn't make sense to Kuhn or even to Lakatos, right? For them, to follow a paradigm is to believe it. To follow a research program is to believe it. But for Loudon, once we say, okay, we can have this collection of research programs that make up a research tradition, there's nothing to say that I might look to a research program and say, I don't believe that, but there might be something of value there. There might be some other reason other than the fact that I believe it to be true to work within that research program, to pursue it. So the question becomes why? Would have been something I would ask the class if we were there. But, I'm sure you could think of several reasons. The most obvious would be to disprove it, right? Plenty of scientists have written journal articles arguing that vaccines don't cause autism. To do that, they had to pursue the question of whether or not vaccines cause autism, not because they accepted it, not because they believed it even might be the case, but to disprove it, prove it wrong. That seems the most obvious reason why one might pursue a research program that they don't believe. Another might be that it might be groundbreaking if it's true, right? So if we look at the example of the Dyson sphere around that dimming star that we had used for our example over the course of the semester. The person who argued that probably didn't believe it to be the case, but he said, what if it was? Even if I don't accept it, I'm going to pursue this because even if there's a very small chance that it might be true, if it was, it would be groundbreaking. Likewise, I discussed the article on the Silurian hypothesis that we might not be the first advanced civilization to ever inhabit Earth. Right? There might have been one a million, millions and hundreds of millions of years ago that we would have no evidence of. The scientists who do that don't believe that, but it might be groundbreaking if it were true. Another reason you might pursue a research program that you don't accept is you might say, I think Godfrey Smith summarizes Loudon as saying, like, you might be the best one to do it. It's within my area of specialization. If anybody's going to investigate this, I am. I'm going to pursue it even if I don't believe in it. It might further what I do accept. So one of the reasons these people were working on this hypothesis of, are we the first technologically advanced civilization to live on Earth, wasn't because they accepted it or they believed it to be true. They didn't want to disprove it, but it was because it furthered their work on what impacts are we having to the planet that are going to be seen millions of years from now. Industrialization, global warming, pollution, extinction, all of these things that we are doing now, we should be able to see in the fossil record millions and millions of years ago if another species did it. So, what Licato says is, when we justify pursuing a research tradition, what I can say is I can pursue a research tradition that I don't believe in, and I'm always justified in pursuing it if it has the highest rate of progress, if it's getting the most things done as quick as possible right now, right? The ones that are moving the fastest. So if we look at like oncology, right? Cancer research, we might say that one is always justified in pursuing a research program like proton therapy that is progressing the fastest right now. It's making the largest advances. That's pursuit, not belief, not acceptance. Rate of progress doesn't justify acceptance for Loudon. Instead, one's going to be justified in accepting a research program only if we can show that it has the highest overall level of progress or level of explanatory power. We are always justified in accepting or believing in the research program that can explain the most or that it's the most effective overall, even if it's moving relatively slower now, or even if it's been relatively stable. There's not a lot of new advances going on, but it's still a very effective research program. You might think for cancer treatment, this would be something like chemotherapy. Certainly not the highest rate of progress or new discoveries, but overall, probably along with radiation, the highest level of success, right? So what we're going to discuss then going into next week is that there are these practical concerns with which research program to pursue. Once I say I don't have to believe in a research program or accept a research program to pursue it, to follow it, what other reasons might I have for doing so? How might I do that? What's going on in me and my decision making? One of these might be how many others are pursuing it. Talk about that. One of these questions might be, if I can say that we can work in a research program that we don't believe, how do I best allocate scientists in a research lab? How do I put them into different research programs under this research tradition? How do I say you're going to work here, you're going to work here, you're going to pursue proton therapy, you're going to pursue chemotherapy, you're going to pursue radiation when working within the research tradition of cancer treatment, right? How do I motivate scientists to work in different research programs that they don't believe in? All these questions were going to come up in the sociology of science that we start for next week or for next class. So that was your first lecture in Philosophy of Science Online. Yeah, so these lectures will stay up for the rest of the semester. So if at any point you'd like to review, if you are one of the questions for the final essay will involve Lakatos and Loudon and Fierabend, if you need to review, these will be up. You can return to them whenever you'd like. Yeah, so I'll post the next one for Wednesday. This will be on the next chapter. What is this? Sorry, I'm looking through the book. This will be chapter 8 of Godfrey Smith, The Challenge from the Sociology of Science. That'll be uploaded for Wednesday. Yeah, just be sure to have quiz number 3 done by tonight. And yeah, let me know if you have any questions or if you'd like to meet, shoot me an email. Anyway, hope everyone's doing well. I hope you had a safe break. I hope everyone's staying safe and not being too bored. Watch your hands. And yeah, let me know if you have any questions. And I will post another one of these on Wednesday. See you then.